Thank you, Mohamed. Thank you, everybody, for being here. So the before I start, I need to acknowledge the other co-author, that is Dr. Tarek Al-Kadaji. He is the Vice President for Strengthening Solution and Structural Technologies, and we both work on this load test. So just to give you a brief background, the structure that we had the opportunity to work on is a typical precast structure in which we have precast double T elements that are supported by inverted beams and then columns. The entire structure is precast. It's a very simple structure because most of the elements are all simply supported. So it's the simplest structure that we can have. So what happened was that during an heavy snowstorm, this was the landscape constructor decided to move all the snow on the edge of the building, and that caused some problem to the double T's. And here you can see basically that many of the double T's along the edge of the building, they failed in shear. You can see also you can see also some spalling in the last picture here to the left of the existing concrete. So the approach that we decided to use was to first retrofit the existing structure, and then at the request of the owner to perform a load test to show basically that the shear strengthening of the structure was adequate. The shear strength of the structure was adequate. So the first step is basically to restore the structural integrity. This is done by removing all the spalled concrete and pump new concrete repair material. In addition to that, any cracks that are present in the structure need to be epoxy injected. So basically, this allows to restore the aggregate interlock for the existing element. But once with the structure crack, we cannot count anymore on the contribution of the pre-stressing to the shear capacity. Therefore, what we did, we applied some FRP reinforcement, in particular FRP in the form of FRP in the form of URAP. Basically, FRP URAP works as a stirrup, is bonded along the perimeter of the beam, and increase the shear capacity. In addition to that, we also use an horizontal strip that you see here at the top side. Unfortunately, I cannot use the pointer, but there is an horizontal strip. And this horizontal strip of FRP was used because the cracks were at the top side were quite vertical. And if we put FRP URAP, you would have FRP parallel to the crack. Instead, we wanted to have FRP that was crossing the crack. So we used a combination of horizontal and vertical FRP. So once the strengthening was completed, we had to perform a load test. This load test was very focused. We were not interested in testing the entire double T's. We only wanted to test the area that was the area in which there was a doubt. They were the last 7 feet of our double T. And this test was done basically to confirm only the shear capacity. We were not interested in looking at the flexural capacity of the element. In order to do that, we basically decided to use hydraulic jacks to apply the load. The reason for this, the reason of using concentrated load instead of uniform, was because it allows to have a constant shear along the entire repair area, and not rather constant, but a nice shear along the the entire repair area. And then also, if we use hydraulic jack and shear failure is a brittle failure, we can rapidly remove the load. It also has some drawbacks, which I'm going to talk about during. One drawback is that when you use hydraulic, it's very hard to avoid any leaks in the hydraulic system. So if you perform a monotonic test the last 24 hours, you have to have somebody on site to continuously monitor the structure in order to monitor the equipment in order to keep the load constant. Now, if we want to do a load test, the first thing we need to do is to look at the loading. What amount of load we're going to apply on our structure. This is the loading on the element that we were that we've previously strengthened. We have a uniform flat roof rod of 20 PSF. Then we have a snow drift supercharge with a maximum peak of 41 PSF. In addition to that, we also have a live load. This is a parking structure of 40 PSF. So what is the load test magnitude that we apply to our structure? I forgot to tell you that we performed the translates the I-437.2. And the I-437.2 has two lot combinations, one for statically determined structure and one for statically indeterminate structures. Now, the difference is that for statically indeterminate structure, in which there are different continuity, the load factors are higher. So you have a 1.6 for the live load. So you basically use the full design live load. Instead, in statically determined structure, we have a reduction in the load factor. Instead of 1.6, we use 1.4. In reality, this is only partially true because ACI-437 also has a little clause that says that if we have a statically determined structure, like a simply supported beam, which is our case, but the memory is not tension controlled, and this is our, and since we are testing for shear, is not a tension control failure, then we need to use the load combinations for statically determined structure, indeterminate structure. So we need to use the higher live load. In this case, what you see highlighted in red is the governing load combination, in which we use 1.6 for the snow load and 1.0 for the live load. And that corresponds to a total load of 187 PSF. Now, if we want to test for shear, we need to make sure that in the area that we're testing for shear, not only we reproduce the shear force that is on the element, but we also reproduce the bending moment. This is because the shear capacity is basically affected by the bending, by the flexural demand on the element. In order to do that, we need to do a simple structural analysis, which in this case is very simple, being a simply supported beam. So we decided to use the area of interface fit of our element. We have two options. One is to apply the total lot test magnitude of 187 PSF over the entire area, or we can apply a concentrated force here, 7 feet from the edge. If we do the math, we find that we need to apply a force of roughly 29.5 kips. If we look in terms of shear force diagram, we can see that we can basically replicate the shear force in the first 7 feet, which is the area that we're interested with, but in all the rest of the structure, we have a lower shear demand, which is okay because we have no doubt on the capacity in that area. If we had doubts on that area, on the performance of that area, then we would have to change the way we apply the load in order to have a higher shear along the entire element. Then we need to look at the moment. So if we use that force, we are roughly 8% higher than what ACI-437 requires, which is okay. And then in terms of moment also, if you look at this area that is highlighted in red, that looks more like a pink, the area that is highlighted in red, you can see the demand is roughly 6.6% higher than the uniform distributed load, which is also okay. But what you also notice here, you see that green line represents the cracking moment. If we use this test setup, basically, we can perform the test for shear without cracking the element, which is something that we wanted because this structure is basically located in an area where they use a lot of salt. So it's a very corrosive area. So we wanted to do the load test without affecting the serviceability of the structure afterwards. Now, if in terms of setup, we used a closed loop setup, since we're using hydraulics, the setup becomes a little bit more complicated. Basically, but it's not even there, it's not very difficult. So we apply the load directly to the stems of the WT, like you see here. We use a spreader beam and a jack. Then what we do, we drop an high strength bar through the structure, through the level below, and we put a reaction beam below. This is because the element that we are strengthening is on the roof, so we cannot react against anything that is above, we have to go. And we need to react against the level below. Now, unfortunately, when we use this, the maximum force that we can apply is the weight of the level below, of the beam that is at the level below, and it wasn't sufficient. So what we had to do, we had to put counterweights that we estimated being around 6,000 pounds per stem on the double T at the level below. And this basically avoided, in this way we could avoid lifting the double T at the level below when we were doing the test. In terms of shoring, the fact in the presentation before, we heard that one advantage of using hydraulics is that the shoring can be simplified, because basically we only need to worry about the weight of the element that we are testing. In this case, if the worst that can happen was basically that the double T we are testing fails and falls on the level below. And unfortunately, the level below didn't have enough capacity to support this weight. So we had to shore not one level, but two levels below, because with two levels we were able to support the entire double T. In addition to that, if you see between level 4 and the roof, we also added another shoring tower, but this shoring tower was not in contact with the element, otherwise we were not testing anything. But it was there only in case of failure, just to reduce the amount of how much the beam would move while failing. It's a very hypothetical situation. You can see some of the pictures of the lot set. We have a dial gauge, we have a lot cell that is monitored with the data acquisition system. And here there are some pictures of the spreader beams and the reaction beam. Now, the load was applied using a manual pump, not an electric pump, mostly because it's much easier to control. I don't know if you ever use an electric pump. Once you do the load start going up very quickly. Instead, with the manual pump, you can do it very gradually. And here are some pictures of the counterweight that we're using. We used a bag of sands, our counterweights. The reason being, we wanted to move all the weight all at once, but the weight of the forklift plus the counterweight was too high for the parking garage to support. So we had to leave everything outside and then move the back one at a time. And here you can see some pictures of the shoring and some measuring this device. Now, the way we applied the load, before we applied the load, and this was said very well before, we want to avoid having any contribution from the elements that are next to the one we are testing. So we had to disconnect it from whatever was around. So what we did, we cut the plates, the steel plates connecting the different double T's, but we also went and cut the joint in between the double T's. In this way, basically, we isolated the element. In terms of deflection, we use, in this case, we could measure the deflection from the level below. Unfortunately, since we are reacting against the level below, we would measure the deflection of the roof, but also we would measure at the same time the upward deflection of the level below. So we had to measure the deflection on two levels, between level 4 and the roof, and then between the level 3 and 4. And then our deflection would be the difference between those. In this case, we went for the deflection, we went very low tech. We use manual dial gauges, mostly because we didn't have enough LVDTs to use for this application. But it was okay because the accuracy, the resolution of this instrument was 0.001 inches, and we were expecting a deflection of 0.2 inches. Now, in terms of loading protocols, we decided to go with the monotonic load procedure, and this is because this was the testing for shear, and we have a recommendation in ACI 437 that in the case in which the shear failure is suspected, we recommend to use the monotonic over the cyclic. Mostly because we want to keep the very high load in the shear zone for a long period of time. And this was already described before, so we applied the load in four almost roughly equally steps, and then we keep the load for 24 hours. And then we measure the residual deflection within 24 hours after the load is removed. And here, basically, you can see the load steps that were applied, or in a graphical form, those here you can see that each load step, we kept each load step roughly 5 minutes. But in the great scheme of things, when we have 24 hours wait, it's very little time. Those 5 minutes is mostly just the time to check all the instrumentation, everything is working before we apply the next step. Now, in terms of acceptance criteria, we were using ACI 437.2 that has two acceptance criteria, deflection criteria and a residual deflection criteria. The deflection criteria says that the maximum deflection that we measure during the test, that is called delta test, needs to be less or equal than LT over 180. In realtà, we already know that this criteria is not going to govern in this case, because the expected deflection is 0.2 inches. And this value came back to be 3.3 inches. Now, 0.2, we know that the structure is going to stay elastic during the entire load test. So if we get anything more than 0.2 inches, I would be worried as an engineer because probably there is something else going on. So we are only counting in this case only on the residual deflection. That is the second criteria that says that if we take the maximum deflection, we divide it by 4, we want the residual deflection to be less than this that value. So if we look at our test, the structure behaved the way we expected. It was pretty much linear elastic. You can see that the maximum deflection during the test was 0.184 inches. So if we divide this value by 4, we get 0.046 inches. Our residual deflection was 0.003 inches. That is within the error of the dial gauges. So it really retained the original condition. So the test pretty much passed. And here you can see is the same graph in which we just show the deflection over time. The green line represents if our residual deflection is below this green line, we know that we passed the load test. As you can see, we went way below that line. So in conclusion, we perform the monotonic load test that we performed allowed us basically to verify the shear performance of the structure without only the repair zone. Basically, we were able to do the test without causing any cracking in the structure. Then the structure also passed met acceptance criteria of SCI-47.2. And in this case, a deflection criteria was not meaningful. Actually, there is now a discussion within SCI-47 to remove this acceptance criteria. And it would become consistent with the SCI-318-19. Mostly because in many cases that this acceptance criteria is not meaningful. The criteria main basically that LT over 180 is a limit that allows you not to retest the structure. Basically, if you fail that, if you have a deflection that is greater than that, you are not allowed to retest the structure. And with this, I conclude. And if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer.
Mm-hmm. You raised the question, deflection criteria versus pass-fail mm-hmm. or testing the shear. What's your thoughts on
that? I believe that for shear, when you test for shear, a simple pass-fail criteria is sufficient, mostly because unless we are applying the load on the entire element. Like in a case like this, we knew that we're not going to get a lot of deflection. So basically, if the structure would sustain the load for 24 hours without showing any sign of failure, to me, pass the test, independently on what we are measuring. Oh, yeah. I had the question was whether we ever saw a building that didn't pass the test. And the answer is yes. We have seen several that didn't pass the test. And generally, when it doesn't pass the test, you need to do something in the form of strengthening or... In the worst case, there is demolition, but we don't like that. Oh, the question is whether there was any consideration regarding fire. And the answer is yes. We were in... generally, you don't need to fireproof if the FRP is secondary reinforcement, meaning that if the difference between primary and secondary reinforcement is that for secondary reinforcement, if you lose it, the structure does not collapse. So in that case, you don't need fireproofing. Or if you do your fire analysis, you see basically that after 2 hours, the structure has sufficient strength to resist a load combination of 1.2 dead plus 0.5 live. Then you don't need to fireproof it. In this particular case, however, we were in a jurisdiction that required fireproofing of FRP. So we had to fireproof it. There are some counties that don't allow not to fireproof the FRP. All right, thank you.